After watching the first few videos of the series, you should have a pretty good feel for how to work with the products in your library. But as you start digging deeper into the software, it could begin to look like a foreign language. I mean, at least it did for me. So I wanted to spend the time to really understand how Toolbox is driving all the data inside of these products and what some of these things that I keep seeing even mean, like a formula-driven prompt or a subassembly. And now with the new Foundation Library, since it is worldwide, there may be even more questions about some of that terminology or part names inside of your products. So the purpose of this video is to answer some of these questions and hopefully give you a better understanding of how the software is working behind the scenes. So if you're ready, let's go. Okay, so we're kicking this one off here by getting back into a project. Now this is one that we've already created. So to do that, let's go to our recent projects list and select testing projects. So this is one that we're gonna work on to get a little better understanding of how Toolbox is working in the background, or see if I can explain a little bit more on how Toolbox is working in the background. So to do that, thought it'd be a little bit better to just focus on this one cabinet. We'll isolate it, hide all the rest of them inside of this drawing. Now I'm just updating the size of this wall. I'm just gonna increase it to 100. Okay, so this is the cabinet we had set up from our previous video. We were working in the project properties. Now back into the prompts. Just wanna spend a little more time on some of these formulas and what this red indicates. So on the first one with the width, you know, that one's in red, but it's like I mentioned before, it's, you know, just a conversion formula. So that one's okay to overwrite, but the other ones below, which are also in red, those are the ones we need to be a little bit more aware of. So with the height, depth, and toe kick height and some of the other prompts in here, those are coming in from our project wizard or global variables. And if you were to select that cell and right click, you can show the formula and it brings up this formula editor box. Now we're not going to go into exactly how to read this formula or what everything inside of here means, but it's basically just looking to the type of product that you're using and returning a cabinet height for it. So when we're in our project wizard, we're entering base cabinet height, and that's the value that returns inside of this prompt. The depth, similar situation, right? A little bit more complicated of a formula, but basically doing the same thing. Just looking back to one of our workbooks, like the project wizard, to get that value. So we know about turning these on from our globals, so we don't have to do that locally. So toe kick options, there's another one where we see a lot of these red values. Again, just returning something that's coming in from a workbook. Hardware, the same thing. So now when I talk about workbooks, they're really just spreadsheets. The spreadsheets that we have inside a Toolbox all have different names. So we have, starting at the top with our factory, and then there's the project wizard, going down into our three workbooks that make up the material file. And now all of these workbooks make up one entire spec group. And then the other spreadsheets that we have in here are for the products. So the local product that we've talked about. So that's what we're controlling when we're inside of the prompts page. And then the subassembly workbook and the nested subassembly workbook. All three of those live inside of our products. And now looking at the spreadsheet hierarchy. So each specification group contains these workbooks. You have the factory workbook, which is pulling in all that information from the template and sending it to the workbooks below. And then you have the W, the G, and the D, which are the wizard, the global, and the door, along with the material file, which contains the M, E, and H, material, edge banding, and hardware. And then all those workbooks are driving how the products are coming in from our Toolbox library. This is just an example of three individual products with their notebooks, and just an example of how these workbooks interact with each other. The local workbook, which is the top level, can send information down to the workbooks below, like the S and the N, the subassembly and nested subassembly workbooks. And then just by following this diagram, you can see how those workbooks can speak to each other. This will make a lot more sense as we get into making more customizations to our library. And for now, it's important just to remember that the local is at the top level. So that's where you want to start making the modifications. And then from there, going into each workbook below to make more of the specific customizations. But always start at that top level, the local workbook, by going into the prompts of the product. We would use part properties or edit design data to access more of those workbooks inside of the Toolbox products. And we have other videos that will teach you more about that. So be sure to check those out. So now moving on into our specification groups. So just to give you another visual on these specification groups and the different components inside of them. As you see here, these are the workbooks that we just talked about. These buttons will get you to the UI or user interface. But as you really start getting into library customization, where you're going to be going is inside of some of these workbooks to make a lot more than just one or two changes. These could be some changes you're going to want to do in your entire library. So just a preview of these workbooks. We're not going to dig deep into these right now, but just showing you all the different workbooks inside of our specification group. So all the different workbooks in there. Just remember those letters are referring to those workbook names. So anytime we talk about an L workbook or a W, just referring to the local or the wizard. Something else to keep in mind whenever you have a question working in Toolbox or something comes up you just don't have the answer to or can't find it easily, check out our Microvellum Knowledge Base Network. Selecting that link takes you to our Knowledge Network where you can get a lot of good information. So a lot of good resources, a lot of information that Microvellum has posted on here as far as some documentation. This is a great one, the Microvellum Glossary. So if there's anything that you're not quite sure what it means, a global variable, some of the terms that you come across when working in Toolbox. Along with that, we also have our community, a lot of people providing great help, great information on there, and it's free to sign up. So create an account and take advantage of all that good knowledge-based content. All right, so now the next part of this video, we're gonna go back into our project wizard, make some other changes, just so you can see how this data is working in some of these products. So anything that we put in here, this is what our product's going to be looking at when they try to figure out how to be drawn. So the height, the depth, and what's inside of the additional construction too. So now all the products within the spec group are going to have this tokic assembly style. They're going to have a full top instead of rails. You kind of get the idea how that's working. And in the global file, the same thing. So we would go into our global variables, make some changes here. So this global variable here is currently being controlled by our Project Wizard workbook. And we talked about it in a previous video about how disabling the wizard variables would turn this off and you would have the control to make any change you want here, but that's not recommended. It's, you know, good to leave everything in the Project Wizard. I mean, that's the easier of the two interfaces to work in. That W, again, referencing our wizard workbook, giving us the number of base shelves. Now there you can see inside of our general construction settings, we have these changes that we just made in our Project Wizard. So they're in red, letting us know that that's where they're being controlled, but you can see how they update inside of this global variable workbook. I want to change my tall back construction here in the global variables instead of doing it inside of the props. Same with the upper back construction. You know, if there's anything else in here we want to make sure we have on for the project, let's do that now even before we start adding a bunch of products too. I mean, it's not as bad if we just got to go back and redraw some things, but the more that we can do in here at the beginning, the better. Now here, I'm just going to change some of the door reveals so we can see them update inside of the product. And now again, if we're looking for a variable we can't find, we can go into the Edit tab and select Find Variable. Just start typing in a letter, get you closer to the variable you're looking for. That one we want to turn off our Add Countertop Drawing Only again. And this is the Hardware Wizard making all the changes inside of that H workbook. So if there's a hinge for one of your angled doors that you want to use that's different than what's currently showing, you can just go into the library and select that new hinge. Set up our cabinet doors with some different pulls. We're going to change our default drawers. Turn that into a wood drawer box. And now that we set up this specification group with all these project settings, we can rename it with something that fits this project a little bit better. You can right click in there to rename that spec group. Give it a unique name. And really, you know, the name of the specification group is up to you, however you want to name it. Just kind of gives you an idea of what the products are going to be inside of that spec group. So HPL cabinets, letting us know that we have some plastic laminate cabinets going on here. And now as we bring in a new cabinet from the library, you can see all the changes that we just made. We had the full top, right? The change from rails. We have those props are now turned on. Here we have that quarter inch door to drawer gap that we set up in the globals. And now with an upper product, also pulling in some information that are only meant for the uppers. And same thing for the tall. So you have the base and the upper and the tall that all have their different project settings and get drawn the way that you have it set up inside of this project. So once you get to a point where you've set up the projects and everything's working the way that you want, you do have the option now to save everything to the template or the library level. So now these different components that we've set up can be used for future projects. Now you can save the component alone just by saving that up to the template, or you can save the entire spec group, but just be sure that you've given everything a unique name so it doesn't override anything in your template. Give the specification group a new unique name also, just letting us know it's just a dummy spec group. I'm just showing you what we can do when we save it back up to the library level. And now that we have that new spec group with its new unique components, what we can do is save this selected specification group to the template. And now it's letting us know that this specification group has some unique components, and do we want to save these to the template as well? Let's go check that out by going back into our toolbox setup and our library specification groups. And there's that new dummy spec group with all its new components. So those would be the settings that we would have inside of a product using that specification group. That concludes another Microvellum University training session. Thanks again, and I'll meet you back here for the next one.